Welcome to Alaska, with its vast, never-ending display of mountains and glaciers, forests and rivers with animals both large and small. Alaska, the last true frontier left in North America. Come join Adventure Sports Outdoors as we venture forth into the Kenai Peninsula, and join us as we travel down the rivers and on the high seas, all part of our journey of exploration on this, the Great Alaskan Adventure of 2007. Hi, this is Harry Canterbury for Adventure Sports Outdoors. This show marks part four in our five-part series called The Great Alaskan Adventure of 2007. Today we go fishing on the Kasilof River for king salmon. The Kasilof, like its counterpart, the Kenai River, is one of the truly great Alaskan fishing rivers. But unlike the Kenai, where motorized fishing boats are used, this is a river where you float down to catch your fish in drift boats, and that makes for a very special fishing experience. So join us today as we float down to Kasilof River in search of the elusive king salmon.
Adventure Sports Outdoors, brought to you in part by Gutters and More, featuring gutter top relief protection system in East Peoria.
Embassy Suites for the best lodging in the Peoria area, 309-694-0200.
Anna and Hannah PC, attorneys at law, the outdoorsman's friend, Peoria. John Anderson Auto Care in Washington, Illinois, where service and quality go together. And Gander Mountain, Peoria's finest sports store.
It's 2:30, man. 3:30.
There were seven of us going on this float trip. HB and I, Vince and Cheryl Hagen from Tremont, Illinois, Carl Woods from Chester, England, and Bob and Pam Conan from Hitchcock, South Dakota. This was going to be exciting, and we were all really looking forward to it.
I can't catch a bigger one. Let's see, where do you want
the stairway leading down to the boats was probably the hardest part of the whole trip. That last step was a real doozy. And once again, we'd be floating down the Kasilof River in one of those special boats designed for this kind of fishing, the Willy Boat. Tommy Core has been guiding for quite a few years, and he knows this river quite well. We were on the water by 5 o'clock in the morning, just as the sun was coming up. Our other guide was Ian, another experienced guide, a Marine just back from Iraq. And so we were in pretty good hands.
Go out, we'll do it again. You hold it out, you'll press this button, you go. One. Just count that as your half.
Okay.
So this will be one, two, over here.
Three.
And then four. That's four and a half.
Okay.
Okay.
This is a good sign.
We're working on it.
Okay, I'm just making sure we go through the moves so we're ready for it.
Is that Carl?
Kind of hold it up.
There you go.
We're trying to, yeah.
Isn't that Carl?
Okay, so when the rod goes down, it's going to be pulling it down, just give it just a little, you don't want to, don't snap it back too hard. Right, just kind of lift it up.
Okay.
Just lift it up, just go.
Like a black putt.
What sizes can we keep and what do we have to put back in?
Anything on this river you can keep,
okay.
Any size. If it's less than 20 inches, it's called a jack.
Okay.
You can keep 10 of them and not even tag it.
Okay, there he is.
There's a fish.
That's a nice one.
Way to go, Carl!
Way to go.
Carl means business today.
That's right. He's getting away from me today.
That's right.
Oh, he wasn't very big. They 20 minutes.
That first fish was under 20 inches, and they're called jacks and are usually returned to the river to allow them to mature. Didn't matter to Carl. He had come to fish.
Only on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays can you keep a fish that has its head. The ones that are clipped are hatchery fish. You've got to let them go.
This is a beautiful river and chock full of fish. Even if you didn't catch a single fish, the beauty was worth every minute. But we didn't come for the scenery. We came to catch salmon. And Carl started the whole thing rolling. The Kenai and the Kasilof Rivers are the best-known fishing rivers in the Kenai Peninsula. While the Kenai River flows fast and furious, the Kasilof River is a much more gentle and floatable river. And that's why these special float boats were developed to allow the river to glide by while maintaining their position in the river.
He got one.
Nice fish. That's a good one. Nice. What do you think it weighs?
It's going to be about 23.
That's a nice fish.
The really neat thing about floating a river is that you have time to see all the birds that fly about. We saw gulls and eagles and all sorts of other birds. And on several occasions, we heard the loons with their distinctive calls. As we were heading down, we interrupted a moose cow and her calf trying to cross the Kasilof River. You have to be very careful when Mama Moose is around with a young calf. She can get really mean. She could very easily charge the boat to send a warning.
We could have had her right in our lap.
Oh, yeah.
Heartbeat.
Yep.
You see where they are up by that rock up there? Freddie Pence had a fish on. That fish was going nuts down there. Moose came across there, ran into the line, broke that fish off, and they had it on video. I need that video guy because ain't nobody back home going to believe Moose broke my fish off.
But this time she elected to go back the way she'd came.
For now.
For now.
We'll probably cross down here.
Yeah. We got a problem right here.
Yeah, I can't get up there.
Yeah.
Her calf was probably less than 2 weeks old and doing pretty well on its own.
She took off running up through there. That mud was about that deep, right?
Yeah.
And all of it down there.
Cool.
That's okay. Stay up there.
We saw other boats and a gentleman along the shore pulling in fish, but we were yet to hook into a good salmon of our own. That, however, would change.
Well, go ahead and see.
Well, I don't believe you.
Huh?
I believe you.
Okay.
I just don't know why it went.
Okay. Well,
I'm winding and not.
Okay, bring it in. I got to redo it.
I'm winding in that tight.
Was he a big hit? Did you feel it?
What'd you do, John?
You know, it is all right to hit that fish. Hey, jump right in the middle of the boat there. Jump right in the middle of the boat. Right up there. Put your knees between the hole. Change seats. Now you change seats. Put your feet between the hole. Well, just stand up there and stand on it. It's fine.
Thank you.
on him?
We're going to stop.
Oh, get back that sucker around here. I gave away that hole for that. Okay.
Come around.
Small fish. We're gonna kick him loose. He's wild. He's got the adipose fin. If you look, you see the adipose fin there? That yep. means we have to let him go.
Yep.
Okay.
Huh. That well, you got your fish in.
Well, managed to at long last. Thank you very much. We managed to hang on to one in your road. Over here.
He's taking pictures of your ugly face.
Is that my ugly face you need? Is that beautiful silver thing out there?
Well, it's in the water. It's just water.
Oh, that's true.
We gotta wait till we see.
Well, you'll see this.
We
ugly...
have to see the action. You'll see the action.
You'll see this ugly face crying when he comes off.
Our guides kept instructing us over and over again. When you had a fish on, you were to pull the rod up, and then as you lowered it towards the water, you were to reel in the extra line so that there was a constant pressure on the line. This is done so that the salmon doesn't have time to spit out the plug.
Oh, baby, look at that.
Okay, I want you to do something.
Whatever you say.
I want you to put the rod tip towards the water and back towards me. Towards the water and back towards me.
Okay.
Bringing him right on over. Okay, reel down to him. That was a funny one. He bit, he let go, he bit. And the only thing he could have done is bit it and picked it up.
Carl caught the first big salmon, and even though it wasn't one of the 50 pounders from earlier in the week, it was still a good one and a keeper. He did a fine job of landing
it. That's a good one. That's a good one. Nice fish, Carl.
Look at that. We got to keep a fish.
23.
Oh, finally.
National night job.
Buddy. Well, there, hey, how come you lost six? You got one on your seven. Seven's your lucky number,
that
buddy.
Baby down there.
Well, what do you say to that, there, Lamy?
Thank you very much for staying on the hook. It's nice, isn't it?
You're thanking the fish, huh?
Oh, thanking the fish for staying on the hook. After my last two excursions, I'll have one, thank you.
Well, you had a whole bunch of, you know, had some hits. You had about six this week?
It's, and that's the first one that's really stayed on the line. Well, not bad. We had the two we had to let go, didn't we, before, what do you call the jacks?
Well, they can sure screw you up, right?
Oh, they do, yes. Ow! Oh, son damn. Of a fish.
As soon as you catch a fish, you gotta write it down, right?
Yeah. Not crowded down here for you, is it? Let me see.
You're having all
the luck. Huh?
You're having all the luck.
I ain't having all the luck.
Carl, how many Carhartleys did you catch today?
Two.
Two Carhartleys. You could hardly call them a fish, huh?
You could hardly call them a fish. But never mind.
You know, what'd you tell me? You wanted to keep them?
Yeah, that's what he's saying. He said, back home, he said, those are keepers. So we do things a little different up in England. Over in England.
We're grateful for what we get.
Oh.
Not long after Carl caught his fish, Cheryl latched into a beauty. She was determined to land this fish, and it put up a pretty good fight.
That line tight. Here, hand me those rods back.
Okay.
Yeah. Hand me the rods back. Go ahead and latch them up and hand them back.
Don't horse it. Just slow and easy.
slow and easy. Here, hold on, hold on. You ain't making any room. Lift up slowly. Now reel down. Don't drop the rod first. Lift up. Now reel down. In your crotch. Here, hand those rods back whenever you're ready.
Exciting.
All right. And what'd you learn from that? What your guide is telling you, what'd you learn?
To when I drop the hook.
When it goes slack. You pull back and then you reel down, keeping the tension in the line and keep it as low as you
keep
can.
It, low.
So it runs under the boat, you got to get that tip down.
Get the tip
Otherwise,
down.
If you pull it up, you can snap. But you did a great job because you acted reflexively.
Well, right. Thank you.
Let's go do that again.
Yeah, let's go do that again.
Wore me out, though.
Were you expecting
it
that?
It felt good.
Were you expecting that?
No. No, I wasn't. The other one wasn't like that at all.
I know. This was quite a fight. And you did practice the whole thing, so cool.
Man, you're the hot.
Yeah, I told you that was not going to be the hot spot.
So what do you think of King Salmon Fishing?
I love it.
Yeah, I bet you do.
I love it.
You've done it twice now.
I love it.
Yeah, outstanding. In the family, you've done quite well.
I'm ready for the halibut, though, now. I'm primed.
Huh? Pam Conan had the distinction of catching a salmon. However, it had already been filleted for her.
We're looking for one that still wiggles.
Oh, darn. Now you, what did you tell me that
Ones
before?
That still wiggle, okay? And got a little bit of flesh left on them.
You just pulled that so hard, it wiped the flesh right
That's
off.
That's right, man. Look at hook set.
Thank you.
I'm here with Tom Corr, and we're at Terry Johnson's Lodge, the Salmon Catcher Lodge in Soldotna, Alaska. And we've been having a great time here, but I'd like everyone to meet Tom Corr. And Tom has been here since 1956, came here as a young man. He was about 6 years old. His father came here to be a homesteader. And you got to live the life that all of us outdoorsmen would really like to live. You've lived in a land of opportunity for hunting, for fishing, and you've made a good living for your family here, too. You love Alaska, don't you?
Alaska's home, and I love it.
And you wouldn't go anywhere else, would you?
Well, I'd always come back here.
I'd go other places, but I'd always come back. Well, I'll tell you what, I know why you stay here, because it's the opportunities for fishing and hunting for the outdoorsman is tremendous. I mean, there's virtually everything from moose hunting, caribou. You've got the fishing, the salmon, the halibut, and all sorts of other species of fish and game located here in the Kenai Peninsula.
I say I'm more than adequate as a log house builder. I build log houses in the winter and fish in the summer.
But I want to thank you personally for a great time. Everybody had a ball. And I say this, and I, with no hesitations or reservations, time fishing for king salmons in Alaska, you got to see Tom Corr.
After the highlight of fishing on the river, we invited everyone over for a cookout. We had HB's friend, Mike and Jan Connolly from Wisconsin, and our guide and friend at the Kenai Museum, Maya Renkin, and her husband, Aaron, a local Soldotna police officer. And of course, Tommy Corr joined us with his new black lab pup. Tommy even did some cooking for us, salmon and cream cheese done Cajun style.
We're making some
good old Louisiana salmon, if that's possible. Just get it cooked in butter as fast as you can cook it.
Yeah.
Roll. Put a little butter on it, maybe. A little salt and pepper. A little dill if you want to. And put some cream cheese on it. And I don't like cream cheese, and I don't like salmon, but I like cream cheese and salmon.
Yeah, I have to show you, this is my chief cooking bottle washer. This is Pam.
What a story.
And she, I tell you what, when you go to South Dakota, you don't leave hungry. And she makes sure of that. Best food in South Dakota, Pam Conan. And now she's doing salmon today.
See how good Pam is? Look at that.
Perfect fit.
That's a good girl right there.
Yeah. Let her cook.
King salmon at its best.
Another great
with sour
meal.
Cream. Another great meal here at King Salmon Lodge.
Here we are. Another great meal at the Salmon Catcher Lodge.
That's right.
Look at this.
Hey.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, isn't it delicious?
Yes.
We are here eating the salmon that was caught less than 24 hours ago.
Uh-huh. That's correct.
By anyone we know?
Well, this gentleman here.
Oh, my Lord.
Oh.
Yep. Oh, too bad.
Caught him a whopper.
Outstanding.
It was great.
Fantastic.
Very, very.
I think Bob and I both caught the salmon.
Yeah.
And I think this is Bob's salmon we're all eating tonight, because mine's still all in the freezer.
We won't talk about that.
When you're around Carl and you listen to his English accent, you get used to it. But we had to ask him to explain how English differs from our old American slanguage. And he gave us a rundown on the translation.
Hi, we're going to have a little English and American translation this evening. You guys, we always say we're always the same people separated by a big stretch of water and the English language. Today, while I was travelling around with you guys in the vehicle.
Blokes,
then? Yeah. You know, guys for America, blokes for English.
Yeah.
If we was in the vehicle, and I happened to say to Harry that the boot was open, and of course I got a lot of glances off you guys. What's the boot? And the boot in a vehicle in England is what you guys call the trunk. Same thing in the front of the vehicle. You call it the hood. We call it the bonnet. a few other, what was the other one? Oh, yes, if we're in a, you guys, if you're in a line waiting for the cash counter or whatever, we call it a queue. You guys call it a line. It's just a difference in the English language.
And the amounts and the costs?
Yeah, sure, the amounts and the cost. If you look at the price of gas, again, gas, you guys over there call petrol gas. Yeah. We call it petrol. Price-wise, what's a gallon of petrol in the States at the moment? About $2.99, $3. Mm-hmm. Britain, at the moment, it'll cost you the equivalent of $9 a gallon.
Aluminium, you should do that one.
Well, yeah, again, aluminium, we pronounce aluminium, aluminium. You would say
aluminum.
Aluminum. The loo. Yeah. Or you guys say 12 gauge. We usually say 12 ball. Yeah. Oh, in the bin.
But it's rubbish.
A pound and a quid. Which is more?
Same.
Oh, yeah. That's good. Thank you for a little education.
Translation.
Yeah, translation.
This is today's English lesson over for our friends in the colonies.
If you're not out there hunting, you should be. Hunting is a great way to enjoy the outdoors with your friends, family, kids, or even by yourself. Nowadays, we're so busy, we don't take time for ourselves, and hunting is a great way to relax. Or if hunting's not for you, bring your camera with. You can capture wonderful things on film and show it to your kids or friends. I'm Marie Broberg, and this is your tip of the week.
We hope you enjoyed our show today. Our final show of the Alaskan series will air at the end of December, and we'll be bringing you those special moments we weren't able to show you until now. We toured a local brewery outside of Soldotna, and we visited the 2004 Iditarod winner to see how he raises his sled dogs. And we'll also show you a lot of special places off the beaten path. And the month after that, we'll be going back to Conan's Dakota Pheasant Acres for another incredible pheasant hunt. So thanks for joining us today, and we'll see you next month.
Hey, this is Bob Conan from Conan's Dakota Pheasant Acres with Tip of the Week. Guys, when you're hunting pheasants, carry your shotgun at port arms. That way you're always ready with your finger on the safe. When a bird gets up, you're ready, and you just have a lot better luck. I see a lot of guys carry their gun over their shoulder like this, but by the time the bird gets up and flies away, the time you're ready is out of range. So if you're going to limit out, be prepared, fellas.
Adventure Sports Outdoors, brought to you in part by Gutters & More, featuring gutter topper leaf protection system in East Peoria.
Embassy Suites for the best lodging in the Peoria area, 309-694-0200.
Hanna and Hanna PC Attorneys at Law, the outdoorsman's friend, Peoria. John Anderson Auto Care in Washington, Illinois, where service and quality go together. And Gander Mountain, Peoria's finest sports store. We'll be right back.